you're looking for a good friend, look for the Holy Ghost. Look for the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the only one that will never, never disappoint you. Catherine Kuma says, our best friends is the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, we are here together. We welcome you in this place. We thank you for the glowing presence. We thank you for your glowing light. We know you are in this place. We have no doubt. We trust you. We depend on you. Our life revolves around your dictations, around your principle and your will. We are imperfect people seeking to be perfect in your presence. Lord, we're here because we need a touch. Touch us, for your servants are listening. In Jesus' name, amen. Put your hand together for the 11th. This morning, I want you to quickly. Last week, we started a topic, I believe. It's a very good topic, I believe. Follow that message, it will bless you. We've started a topic which I called exceeding righteousness. And I told us last week that exceeding righteousness is called dikaiosyn in Greek, meaning justification of character or innocence. We can call it right standing with God. And I tried to explain to us, you know, the place of being the righteousness of Christ and living a seeding righteous life. We told us that in righteousness of Christ, you don't need to grow in it. You are already righteous. If you are the righteousness of Christ, you are the righteousness of Christ. And we don't want to go into that right now. But there's another kind of righteousness which many pastors do not talk about. We told us that it is called a seeding righteousness. This kind of righteousness, you grow in it. You become better in it. You grow from glory to glory. It's a righteousness that has what we call a service dimension. The righteousness of good moral, the righteousness of good personality. You know that people you see, they have a good aura. The moment you see them, you just connect with them because they have a good aura. But they have something, you know, that they're not ordinary. But there are people you see, something drives you away from them. So this, you know, a seeding righteousness, the righteousness of living what you say. And that's, and we build that scripture from book of Matthew. I want to show you many scriptures today, please. I want you to listen. The hardest people to minister to is old Christians. Because old folks think we have heard it. We have read that scripture before. Who are the old folks in this place? We pray for you. They think we have heard it before. So this scripture, Matthew 5, verse 20, that is where we bet, you know, we connected our topic from. But before I read this scripture, I was asking myself this week, I said, is there Christians? Do we have Christians on earth? Ask your neighbor, are there Christians on earth? Because if I think about the life of Jesus Christ, honestly, Christ-like. Christians mean Christ-like. If I think the way Jesus lived his life, I think we are playing games. Honestly, we are playing games. When the righteousness has been watered down in the church. Nobody talk about righteousness anymore. Pastors don't preach about righteousness. Come as you are, go as you are, dress as you are. Christians, we are just Christians, but we don't truly live it. Hello? There are too many things we react to that we ought not to react. So I this week I was questioning when I'm driving, do we have Christians? Are we Christians? Or are we trying to step in there? Or are we deceiving ourselves? So this question must be in your heart. Are you Christian? The Bible says, examine yourself whether you are stay in the Lord. Because we can live a life of delusion for years. And then at the end of the day, the person heads to hell. The worst thing that will happen to you is to enjoy everything on earth and go to hell. That is hell and that is heaven. God have given me revelation of hell when I was in Korean heaven. And I went to hell, the Lord. And there, I was crying. I don't supposed to be here. I'm not supposed to be here. And I heard a voice ask God for confess bitterness. I confessed bitterness. And I was still crying. I'm not supposed to be here. The fire was there. It was like shaves. And, you know, if you have, and when you have shaves, you know shave. you know, levels of shave. But that is a shave of iron. It has iron. It's iron shave. And it was boiling. It was burning. So it was still burning. I said, I'm not supposed to be here. Something said, confess anger. Ahead of us, I confess anger. I was still crying. A voice said, confess unforgiveness. So I confessed not forgiveness, bitterness, and anger. And then I was translated into a place. It's like a green grass, a beautiful place. So beautiful. And I was being driven like with something like, it's not a car, you know, just on this level, but it was driving me around. And I see people, you know, below that beautiful place. And I was crying and saying, how can I bring my people in here? How can I bring my people in here? So that day, after that day, I knew that there is heaven and there is hell. So if you're living your life as if you're not dying, one day at least, I think the highest you have in this earth is 120 years. Hello, after 120 years, you probably will possibly leave this world. So stop living as if you own this place. Talk to your neighbor, say, you don't own here, you don't own here, you don't own this place. Please talk to your neighbor and say, you don't own this place. You don't own it. You don't own it. So live the life of Jesus. We still come back to the scripture. Yesterday I went to a conference and the pastor called me. I didn't plan to pray for any. I just went to receive. Last year I was one of the speakers in the conference. This year I just went to be in the conference. And after the pastor called me to pray for the people and another pastor who was there. So I literally prayed for almost everybody there because they were coming from one line. So everybody, you know, go from this minister to another minister. And God, it's like God opened a prophetic atmosphere. And God was giving me a prophetic word. It was so prophetic. And one of those ladies I met, I looked at her. She was probably about 40-something years. And the Lord said to me, she doesn't have a husband. But I'm thinking, if you look at her, she looked like she do have a husband. She looked like, you know, you can't ask somebody of 40-something years if she's married, do you have a husband? I was struggling to say that. But I wanted to say, do you have a husband? I quickly said, where is your husband? She said, oh, well, no husband. I said, you mean he's not here or? He said, no, I have never been married before. I said, God. I said, the Lord say I should ask you. I know you don't have a husband, you know, but I should ask you. And she burst into tears. But she came from Australia to the conference. So, and I didn't have the details then. But after preaching, after the prayer, I felt in my heart to give her my book on bloodline. I think that what she's dealing is something related to that. But she didn't. I didn't ask detail when I prayed for her. I just prayed and asked God to remove every veil that have masked and covered her. So, but after the conference, I said to the pastor, please, I want to give one of your members my book on bloodline. She said, oh, she came from Australia for this conference. But I said, I don't have the book here. Are you able to take it? She said, she's going today. I said, okay, are you able to pick up the book tonight? He said, where are you living? I told him, we are living in the same area. So he's going to come and pick it up. So when he came last night, I ran after 10 or 11 to pick up the book. So I asked him, say, who is the lady? She said, oh, she came from Australia. She said, she actually came because of what you mentioned. She said, her grandmother or her mother sacrificed her to idol. She was sacrificed to idol. And they say she's not going to get married. And I have no way of knowing that she have any problem to do with marriage, if not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can actually support you. I have no way of knowing. I just went to the conference. The pastor didn't talk to me. I don't know her. I haven't seen her before. The pastor said she actually came from Australia because somebody gave her my number and told her about her conference to come and be prayed for. This is exactly why she's here. She's not been married once in her life. But the Holy Spirit supported her. So you've got to always listen to the Holy Spirit. And then learn to obey. Sometimes when the Holy Spirit speaks, don't struggle. It may not sound theologically correct or politically correct, but just say it, by the way. When you say it, you'll be surprised what the Lord will do. Hello? So please learn to obey God, learn to listen. When you study the scripture, learn to listen. Anytime I'm studying the scripture, I have not gone to the message and my time is running out. I'm always with a pen. Sorry about it. Praise God. I'm always with a pen. I'm always with pen and small book writing. I'll be studying the word. God will be giving me another thing I'm writing down. So study with something in your heart. Study to know. Study to to connect more with God. Amen? Hello, somebody. Quickly read the scripture, shall we? For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. You shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Look at that scripture. For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall what? Exceed, go above, beyond the righteousness of the Pharisees and scribes, you shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven. It means even the Pharisees are righteous people. We read the scripture last week, and this is the main scripture for this topic. Even the scribes, we are called righteous by Jesus. One of the best sermons Jesus Christ preached was the Sermon on the Mount. He took his disciples after healing people in chapter 4 of Matthew, and they were all pursuing him, wanting more food and more healing. So Jesus Christ decided to go to the mountain. It's been said it was the Mount Olive. And then he sat there and started teaching his disciples. This message is for the selected few. It was not for everyone. He was talking to his disciples. He said, look, even though you've been following me, but he said, if you want to live a better life, if you want to make impact in Jerusalem, you need to live a life of exceeding righteousness. And they were all listening. So when we look at this scripture, we discover that it's a righteousness called the exceeding righteousness. It's not, you being the righteousness of Christ has nothing to do with this kind of righteousness in this scripture. This righteousness has to do with your service dimension in the kingdom. And if you're a child of God, you don't operate in this righteousness, in a higher righteousness or exceeding righteousness, then you must understand that your righteousness is in a lower level. You live the life of what the Pharisees and scribes. And in every church, there are more scribes and Pharisees than more disciples. I don't know if you're one of them, somebody. I'm telling you right now, in the kingdom, you see more scribes, they feel good, they still practice a little righteousness, and they think they are great, but they are living the righteousness of the Pharisees and the scribes. Even the scribes and the Pharisees, we are assumed to be righteous, or even Jesus said that we are righteous, but theirs was a lower righteous life. So many Christians are in this dimension. They are in this level, hello. They are good, good Christians, but they don't do anything more than just being a little bit good. They come to church once on Sundays, you know. They don't participate in anything that has been done in the kingdom. Hello, somebody. They don't give their time to God. They give their time to their work, to their bed, and to their children. They live for themselves and not for God. When you live such a life, you are living a lower righteous life. For you to be able to live this kind of life, to walk in this dimension, in this realm, you need a seed where you are right now. Hello, somebody. And then, Jesus, in the book of John, chapter 14, verse 30, John 14, verse 30, Jesus said something. Because when people say something, you get to watch if they do what they say. Hello, somebody. The Bible, God says, I honor, I exalt my word. I've exalted my word above all my name. Anytime God says something, if you trust it, you find out he keeps what he says. God is a covenant-keeping God. He cannot make you a promise and abandon you. Some of you here have a promise from the Lord, and it looks like that promise is not going to come true. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Everything God has told you is coming to pass in this season. In the name of Jesus Christ. So when Jesus Christ made that, when I read that statement, I mean the book of Matthew, so I wanted to find out if Jesus Christ actually lived a righteous life. And as I looked up through the scripture, I saw his life. He said here, hereafter I will not talk more with you, for the prince of this world cometh and had nothing in me. Jesus said, the prince of this world cometh and had nothing in me. The world, the prince of this world cometh, has to do, the prince of this world have come to accuse me. They have come to accuse me. Remember, you can be accused by people, but it doesn't mean you've done what they said you did. Hello? Even Jesus Christ was accused by many. He said, but they have come, but they will not find anything in me. If you read Aramaic Bible, plain English, Aramaic Bible translation, it says, after this, I will not be speaking much with you, for the prince of this world is coming and has nothing to use against me. He has nothing to use against me. If you use New American Standard Bible, it says, I will not speak much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming, and he has nothing in me. And then Weymouth New Testament says, in future, I shall not touch much with you, for the prince of this world is coming, and yet in me he has nothing. So Jesus Christ was so sure that the enemy, though they have come to accuse him, but they have nothing in him. They can't find anything. Wow. What a higher level statement. This is a superior statement. Hello, somebody? Hello? Please turn to Isaiah 53, verse 7. If you can say this, I say, Lord, can I ever say that people may have, you know, the best place to be is to be in a situation where people will say stuff about you, and yet you've not done that. Hello? Somebody told me that his senior pastor was being accused of all sort of things. The man pastors the big church in Nigeria. And people made all sort of accusation last year. Now, some of the members. And he called all the pastors. He said, please don't defend me. He said, go the message. God has the answer. So the pastor told me, he was here from Korea. I hosted him here last two days ago. He said, they have about 15,000 pastors around the world. He said, they were preaching the message, God has the answer. God has the answer. Say to your neighbor, God has the answer. Oh, talk to your neighbor and say, God has the answer. There are things you are trying to figure out. You are trying to decipher. It's just wondering, why is it happening in my life? Why are they talking about me? I'm good. I've done all that I need to do. But yeah, they don't accept me. And you're wondering, but God has the answer. There are too many things you cannot answer for yourself. Amen. So Jesus Christ was being accused. All sort of accusation was given to him. Yet, after living here on earth for 3 years, he could still say, the prince of this world cometh, but they can't find any single accusation of me. Amen. Oh, somebody's not talking to me. This is a superior statement. This is not a common statement. This is a higher level statement. Can any of us say this? Any of us. Say, no matter what they say, they can't find anything in us. This is actually where we should be aiming to be. Where we should be aiming to go. Wanting to be better. So that in a time we come, you can declare, said, for 10 years, I've not sinned against God. Wow. I listened to a pastor yesterday. He said, so many pastors say, for 10 years, I've not been in the hospital. I've not taken a single drug. He said, but I can also declare for 10 years I've not sinned against God. Hello, that may look like an understatement because everybody's a sinner. Yes, but you also know yourself. The Bible says, examine yourself whether you are still in the Lord. So Jesus made this statement. So my question is, did Jesus actually live a sinning righteous life? Did Jesus live a higher righteous life? Hello? Shall we read the scripture? He was oppressed. And he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. So we saw that Jesus Christ, a lot of things happened to him, but he did not defend himself. Hello. Please, you can close that window. That's a distraction now. Close the other window and put the fan closer to you guys. Please. So Jesus Christ, a lot of things happened to him, a lot of things, yet he did not open his mouth. I said, Lord, do I defend myself every day? Do you defend yourself every day? Hello, church. Do we allow God to defend us? Even Peter, if you look at the book of Peter chapter 2, Peter chapter 2, reading from 21 to 23. In verse 22 also, we are told that there was no deceit in him. Peter bear witness that there was no deceit in Jesus Christ. Hello? There was no deceit whatsoever. I said, Lord, is there deceit in us? Are we deceitful? There are people, there are Christians, but they are deceitful. They only come to church to receive prosperity. They only come to church to hear things that we just, you know, tingle their ears and make them feel great. They don't want to receive something hard. And pastors are pampering the church. Hello? Who did not know sin, neither was God found in his mouth. Hello, somebody. when he was persecuted, he refused to talk like the world. He refused to behave like the world. And therefore, when he was about to depart, he said, the prince of this world cometh, yet they found nothing in me. Because he couldn't allow people to mess up with his higher righteousness. He wanted to live a life of exceeding righteousness. Remember, he was fully God and fully man when he was here on earth. So his main dimension could have reacted, but he refused to react. And this is what it means to be a Christian. When you have been oppressed, marched by people, hello, insulted, do you still laugh and say, Lord, have the answer. God, have the answer. Say to your neighbor, God, have the answer. We don't laugh. We don't take it lightly. We just go to the extreme. I don't mean, there may be times you need to say something, because we are not fools. Christians are not meant to be fools. Hello, somebody. But many times, you are not meant to open your mouth. Hello. You are meant to be quiet and allow God to move and to work for you. Because if God does it, he will do it better. So this was the kind of life Jesus lived. He lived a higher righteous life. Who, when he was revived not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth what righteously. This is what made him to be a higher righteous Jesus. He actually lived a exceeding righteous life. Because we Christians for mad. What does it mean to be a child of God? What does it mean to be a Christian? Just to feel good during the worship? No. Christian is about doing. When you are under pressure, how do you respond? Hello? Some of you, when you're under pressure, everybody have to leave in the vicinity for you. When you're under pressure, wow. We will not know that you carry the Bible. Hello, somebody. I'm just talking to your neighbor, not to you. Talking to your neighbor. Hello, somebody. But this, you know, you cannot tell me you're a Christian. Hello. Every one of us get it wrong once in a while. But if from year to year you are not, you know, you have not built yourself, trained yourself, you have not groomed yourself in such a way that you allow God to respond to certain issues, then you are not a child of God. Christ-like. What does it mean to be a Christian? That must be our question today. Christian? Look here. Sometimes I'm even finding it difficult to tell Muslims I'm Christian. Honestly. Sometimes I try to explain this. So, you know, even though some people are Christian, but they know they're born in Christian family. Because when I'm talking to unbelievers or Hindus or Muslims, I know they're thinking, you Christians are legalizing abortion. You Christians are legalizing, you know, same-sex marriage. Christian pastors and Christian bishops are ordaining same marriage. You know, and they think that everybody's one and they hate us. Hello, someone. Hello, somebody. So I find it difficult to actually quickly say to people, I'm a Christian. I have to explain the kind of Christian. Hello, somebody. I always find myself trying to explain myself. I can't just say I'm a Christian, because those there, they would think I'm one of those who ordain themselves. And some of you don't want to hear this, but I will not stop preaching it. If anyone wants to put me in prison because I say this, I'm willing to go there for the sake of the name of Jesus. Never will I compromise for one day. Never. On this issue. How comes that we are taking things lightly, yet we are Christian? Higher righteous life. How do we live this life? On our daily walk, in our marriage, your relationship with your husband, with your wife, with your children. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. Some of you, once you get home, tension all over. God give you just one life to enjoy. But every day you're living a tension, you know, life. You are tensed all over. Higher righteous life. You cannot claim to be a Christ-like. Hello, if you don't live the life of Christ. He refused to open his mouth when he was insulted. And people will insult you. Hello, somebody. Some of you who feel that you have a call of God on your life, if you don't really feel if you're not very much sure that you have the calling of God in your life, please don't be a pastor, because you will be under pressure every day. A young man came to the other day for counseling. He wanted to start a church, so he needed my technical support. So I told him that the first thing you need to know if you're called. Because one day you question yourself, am I really called? If you're not willing to take pressure, please don't step into it. I actually told him that I don't encourage people to start a church. But I said to them, but if they are sure that they are called, then I will support them. But I don't actually make people do it. Because when you get into it, the things you will see, people will insult you, they will abuse you, they will misread you. You will say things you don't even know about. Hello? And you're there crying, and they are the people you pray for. And you just say, Lord, how is it the people are wicked? You know, people can be wicked. You got to understand, people are not meant to be sweet. Because the wicked people are even the people God uses to raise you up, to train you, and to make you the man or the woman he wants you to be. We are told this morning that you don't go through life, but you grow through life. So when people are squeezing you, you grow through it. I've really grown up. I see so many things I overlook because God have trained me over time, over the years of pastoring in the last 20 years of preaching the word of God. I've seen things. Hello? But that does not mean I'm perfect. But every one of us must strive to reach there. Why are you a Christian? Amen. But you've got to understand here that some of you might be saying, you know what? The reason Jesus Christ lived this life is because he was God. He was a superman. You don't even need to be a superman to live a sin righteous life. Somebody like Paul lived a sin righteous life. If you read the book of Acts chapter 24, verse 16. Acts 24, verse 16. Paul made a statement. Not everyone can say things like this. Hello, somebody, are you here? Not everyone. Is there? And here do I exercise what myself to have always conscience, void of offense toward God and toward man. Hello? Some of you here, you have a conscience that is full of offense toward God and toward man. Do you know so many people are angry with God? Hello, somebody. So many people are angry with God. Everything, they blame it on God. We never hear me, even in my preaching, say, God did this to me. No. I first take responsibility. Say to your neighbor, stop blaming God. Stop. You see, Paul says, I exercise myself. The word exercise has to do with doing something, working, you know, stretching yourself. So I exercise myself to have what conscience that is void of offense toward God and toward men. Meaning you can actually be angry with God. And anytime we have conscience full of offense, hello, this is when bitterness. Because when you are offended, you will transfer it to somebody. Do you know what they did to me today? Okay, let's not talk about it. Let's not talk about it. I don't want them to think I'm gossiping now. But, you know, that church, eh? Okay, I talk to you tomorrow. You just sow a little seed. And somebody start wondering, oh, maybe they are bad. Maybe they are not good. Maybe the church folks are not great. Hello, we sow little seed because we are offended. Offense. You know, once you're offended, it's a bitter seed will begin to grow up. And what happens? You begin to transfer your bitterness to everybody. Hello? And you don't see anything good in anyone because you're offended. How come a Christian, every little thing offends you? Hello, church. You are a child of God. Sorry about a child of God, but every little thing, you know, you get angry. I don't mean we don't get angry once in a while. But the Bible says even when you get angry, make sure that you must not carry it to the next day. And you transfer your pain, transfer your stuff, transfer your attitude to everyone. Everyone becomes a suspect. Even those who mean so much for you, you are suspicious of them because you are not stable in yourself. When you live such life, you are living a lower righteous life. Hello, somebody. You want to be a Christian? Hello? I'm not saying, are you a Christian? Do you want to be a Christian, somebody? Amen. This is the scripture. We make you a Christian. Stop being offended. often, every day. Samuel, book of Samuel chapter 12, reading from 2 to 5. You will discover that at the time Samuel wanted to hand, you know, Samuel made a king, made Saul a king. I did mention that last week. When he made Saul a king and the people came together, he asked them, Samuel, chapter 12, reading from 2 to 5. He asked them, say, have I done anything wrong? We need to read the scripture. And now, behold, the king walketh before you, Samuel told the people, and I am old and gray-headed, and behold, my sons are with you, and I have walked before you from my childhood unto this day. Say, you know me from my young age. You know me. Keep going. He says, behold, here I am, witnessed against me before the Lord and before his anointed. Whose oars have I taken? Or whose ass have I taken? Or whom have I defrauded? Whom have I oppressed? Or of whose hand have I received any bribe to blind my eyes? Therewith that I will restore it to you. Say, tell me, if I've taken anything from you guys, if I've ever defrauded you, you know, if I've ever done anything in order to get stuff from you, say, tell me. Hello, somebody. You may say, oh, God, Jesus lived in sin and righteousness because he was Jesus. Even Paul did that. He lived a life. Paul could say, look, tell me if I've sinned against you. And none of them could accuse Paul of sinning. Nobody could accuse Jesus of Samuel of sinning against them. Hello, somebody. There are spiritual leaders that they do everything. They extort money from the people. None of you will ever say that I've come to get money from you or try to suggest you to give me your thing in a cunning manner. Hello, somebody. Hello. But it can even go that somebody will say your pastor is stealing money and you will believe. But the question is, have your pastor ever steal from you? Hello, somebody. Have your minister ever asked you, can anybody say, have ever come to solicit for their money in the private? Hello. Paul lived this life. Samuel lived this life. Exceeding righteous life. Say to somebody, that is where you're going. Say to your neighbor, that is where you are going. This is where we need to be. No more game in the kingdom. This year we must challenge ourselves. Just challenge yourself. Say to yourself, we want to live a good life. Hello, somebody. This is in 2016. So you must endeavor to live a good life. Maybe when you look at your antecedent, look at your pedigree, look at your history, who you are, where you're coming from, your background, you probably do not see anything that make you feel you can live a good life. But that's a lie from the pit of hell. I see you coming out from that pit in the name of Jesus. I see you becoming a better man, a better woman. The man or the woman God is going to use. Some of you here will be the ones that will change this nation and the world at large. Maybe you carry so much load of sin right now, but you can be better. I say you can be better in the name of Jesus. Somebody like Peter. Some of you know Peter. No, please turn to 1 Peter chapter 3, reading from 19 to 10. This very interesting story. You know, some of you know Peter very well. If read, please try to read about Peter. Peter was a guy, how can I describe? Peter was known to be very inquisitive. He was very impulsive. He was brash. He was a forward guy. A lot of somebody. He was also strong-willed. He was also very enthusiastic. A guy that is willing to do something. But almost everything Peter did, he got it wrong. Almost everything in his walk with God. He was the first to say, always the first to make, funny statement. Oh, let's build a house here, Jesus. I feel so spiritual right now in this mountain. Let's just build a house. Yeah, build a temple, one for you, one for Jesus, and one for Jesus, one for Elijah, one for Moses. Amen. He was the first to say, he was the first to go fishing when Jesus Christ was gone. Hello, somebody. He was the first guy, the first disciple who caught somebody's ear. Peter chopped off ears. Some of you are ear-chopping people. Not talking to me, right? Hello, somebody. Who am I talking to? I'm talking to your neighbor. Peter was an ear-chopping guy. He was the first guy to chop off ear. Meaning, he was a little bit violent. Hello, he was an angry man. But this same Peter was the same guy Jesus Christ entrusted so much. Peter, open you. I will build my church. Oh, somebody is not talking. God is saying to someone, open you. I will build my church in the name of Jesus. It doesn't matter how you feel right now. Maybe you think you are the worst person in this place. Even if God blesses people, he's not going to bless you because your mother didn't train you very well. Your father didn't. You came from the street. You've seen all sort of garbage in your life. I can be better. God only hear the pastors. No, somebody say to your neighbor, no, 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 no. You can still live exceeding righteous life. This same picture was still the same guy Jesus raised up. And anointed him and used him. Hello? In fact, when Jesus Christ resurrected, visited Peter, Peter had gone fishing. In fact, the Bible said, when Peter said he was going fishing, the other disciples said, we are going with you. If you have somebody that is rebellious in the church, you got to watch them because they will make other people think like them. Other guys, they don't want to go to this. People like John, others, they didn't want to go to fishing. But Peter said, I'm going fishing. He didn't say, come with me. He said, I'm going. They said, we're going to go with you. So sometimes people watch what other people are doing. If you come to churches, the leaders are obedient, loyal. Every other person who comes will be loyal and obedient. And they will work hard. But if you come to church where those that are leaders are not doing the right thing, and they are not loyal, they are rebellious, every other person will come will join their footstep. If you come to church where people who were there honors their leaders, those who come will do the same. So life is about foundation. Hello, somebody. So this same Peter, hello, after Jesus Christ restored him, he met him at the river where he was fishing. Right in the sea, Jesus restored him. Jesus can restore you in that place where you are hiding. It doesn't matter the situation you have find yourself or where you find yourself. He will come there, even if you are in the dark. He will come there and sort you out. Hello, somebody. And then he restored him. And then Peter wrote 1 Peter, wrote 2 Peter. And if he reads 1 Peter and 2 Peter, that's one of the best, epistles. Hello. Peter wrote about being holy just as your Father in heaven is holy. He wrote, knowing yourself in Christ, behold you, a royal priesthood, a chosen nation, a person set aside to proclaim the goodness of God. He wrote on the need to defending the gospel, the doctrine of Christ. He wrote on love. He wrote about patience. Wow. The same Peter who was unstable. Hello? But after many years, when he was restored, he became profitable in the kingdom. There are some of you here, you don't even know. When you look at yourself where you are now, you probably would have written yourself off by now. I'm sure some of you have written yourself off. You probably think you will never be used by God. You will not amount to anything. But who told you? We have a God who takes people from the backside of the desert and clean them up and make them the spokesman or woman of nations. And such people are in this place today. In the name of Jesus. Such men that are broken. They are in pain. They don't see anything good. They feel they are uneducated. These are the ones God is looking for. Peter, who was not stable, become an apostolic father. He became the foundation of churches today. He unlocked the door of the Holy Ghost. Hello. But yet, he was a brash kind of guy, very forward kind of guy. He wasn't too good. God is actually looking for you. Hello. If you're here today, you think you're not a good material and you can't live a sitting righteous life because the enemy is always talking to your mind. You've done too much sin. Hello, some of you here, you're always thinking of the sin you've done. You don't even think of righteous things you've done in the past. If you've done too much sin, haven't you done too much good? Have you not done one good thing before? Remind God and the devil of the good stuff you've done in the past. Once you do, the enemy will leave you alone. Peter! Looking at the kind of scripture he wrote, message he brought forth in First Peter, he said, not rendering it evil for evil, or railing for what railing, but contrarywise, blessing, knowing that ye are there unto call, that you should inherit a blessing. Use other translation. You see, the same Peter who used to chop off ears of people, now is preaching peace. Peter have become a man of peace after many years. But he didn't look like a man of peace in the days of Jesus. Hello, somebody. But he was saying, look, please go back to 9. He said, don't render evil for evil. When people do you evil, don't render evil for evil. And I was asking to the Lord, so, was it last year? Why do I need to pray for somebody that have hurt me? Sometimes, you know, people break you. They do all sorts of things against you. There may be times we need to address certain evil. Once in a while, I will address certain rebellion in a way that, the Bible also did mention that you must hand certain people over to Satan. But we don't do that every day. I said, Lord, why do I need to bless somebody that have cursed me? And the Lord gave me a word and said, when you bless people that humiliated you, it doesn't mean that they will be blessed. Hello? Am I talking to somebody? It doesn't mean because you pray for somebody that humiliated you, that prayer is going to bring blessing to him or her. Because God himself said, I will be the one to curse. He said, you blessed, but I am the one that we curse. So when I bless, the blessing actually comes to me, just like when he said, Brother Michael, say, God bless you. Hello. When I say, God bless you, or good morning, the good flows from me first, even before it comes to you. So anytime I say, you are blessed, God bless you. You know what? I am blessed. If I say, God bless you 100 times a day, I've been blessed 100 times because it flows from my soul. The recipient of the blessing you release is not even your opening. It's not even your opening. It's not even the person. You are the first recipient of that blessing. That's part of some of the things I share in the book, Understand the Matters of the Heart. So God said, bless. So Peter said here, please, bless people that bless, that curse you. He said, don't render evil for evil. He said, you know why? He said, because you are called for blessing. Hello, somebody. You are meant to bless. He said, this is your destiny. Hallelujah. Oh, glory. Please read the scripture again with understanding. Not paying back evil for evil or insult for insult, but on the contrary, giving what a blessing. Since you were called for this, so that you can inherit blessing. Oh, nobody is talking to me. Since you were called for what? Called for blessing. Why? So I am called to bless. Oh, somebody. Look at that scripture. You are called to bless in verse 10. You are not called to curse. There is no nature of curse in you. Soon you are born again. The day you were truly born is the day you were born again. Not the day you came to earth. In fact, Apostle Jim Peter helped me to understand it better last time. He said that day is the day you came to earth. Your birthday is your egg day. So today we celebrated the 8 days of Sister Alan Brooke Kingsley. And who again? And Sister Honor. The day they came into the earth. But the day you were born is the day you were born again. You received Jesus into your life as your Lord and your personal Savior. And from that day, you were ordained to be a blessing. Say to somebody, I'm a blessing. Oh, hallelujah. He said, you are called to bless. Wow. I feel to jump up. I don't know who I'm talking to. I feel to jump up. A blessing. So I'm called to bless. I am not called to curse. That is not my nature. Cursing is not my nature. Bitterness is not my nature. Gossiping is not my nature. That is not my call from the day I came into the kingdom. Then he said, for one who wants to love life and to see good days must keep his tongue from evil and watch his lips from speaking deceit. If you must do what? If you love life, for the one who wants to love life or who loves life and to see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking what? Deceit. The same Peter who used to cut off ears, the same Peter who used to revenge every day, is the same who is saying, please, don't say anything negative. Don't curse people back. Don't fight them. He said, because I know what it means to live a certain righteous life. How did I was how is it that Peter knew about this? He what Jesus, he knew the only way Jesus Christ could have walked in the anointing, healed people, was because of the kind of life Jesus lived. So he watched Jesus heal, watched Jesus show mercy to Mary Magdalene. Is it Mary Magdalene? He lost somebody, the woman caught in adultery. She saw Jesus show mercy to Zacchaeus. Some of you, you condemn everybody as a sinner, but you don't even know that you used to be there. Before you came and become a child of the light, you were living in darkness. And some of you, you don't know how to show mercy right now. You're too judgmental. You know why we are judgmental? It's because we think we are super spiritual. Some of you think you are really super spiritual. And one of the things God does to break people that are judgmental is to allow the enemy to buffet their life with sin so that they will tone down a little bit. Hello? So, as a child of God, you've got to know that it is possible to move to another level of life. Hello? Even if your life is erroneous life, most flawed life, you can still see your present negative experience. Peter exceeded himself. Peter, the unstable. Peter, the talkative. Hello? Peter, the emotional. Hello, somebody? Peter, the dumb Christ. After 3 years of theological school, still become Peter, the anointed. Preach blessing, preach healing, preach forgiveness, preach holiness, preach understanding ourselves in Christ Jesus, knowing who you are. So there is hope for you. If you're here today, you think that, oh, you've been written off, it's lie. You've not been written off. There is hope for you. I say there is hope for you in the name of Jesus. So learn to walk in peace. Hello? Peace is one of the ways you can live exceeding righteous life. The book of Hebrew chapter 12, verse 14, did mention. It said, be in peace with all what? If possible, be in peace with all men. If possible, pursue peace with what? Everyone. And what? Holiness. Without it, no one will see the Lord. Church, please, don't look at your watch. Look at the watch of the scripture. Who are those looking at the watch now? I still have one more hour. Praise God. Oh, praise God. Amen. Okay, come back now. Shall we already pursue what? Peace with everyone. With some people? The Lord. With some of your friends? Some of your homeboys or homegirls? The Lord. With what? Everyone. Pursue peace with everyone. Even with your husband. Oh, I don't know who I'm talking to right now. Somebody. Or with your wife. With everyone. No one is excluded. It's with everyone. And holiness. Holiness has disappeared from the church. Listen to the sermons around the world. Holiness has disappeared. We still need to be holy. If you exclude holiness from Christianity, we become a secular club. Once holiness is excluded from Christianity, then Christianity is reduced to a secular organization. What makes us extraordinary people is a life of holiness, extraordinary fellowship and participation with the Lord. He said, without it, no one will see. No one will see. Some of us here, we quarrel with everyone. Everyone you have ever met, you quarrel with them. I don't mean people quarreling with you. They're different from people just hurting your face. You know what? There are people immediately they see you. You've not done anything to them. They just hurt you. Hello? And you're wondering, what have I done? But I mean you hurting and quarreling and fighting them. You are not supposed to, because you are called for a blessing. Higher righteousness, exceeding righteousness. How can you live that life if you don't live a life of peace? The people in this church, you are in the same church, but you may not be talking to somebody in the same church. You don't want to see somebody, oh, he did something to me some few months ago. I don't want to see that person. I don't want to see her. Even if she would make me not to go to heaven, I'm ready not to make heaven. How comes? I mean, you can't be in hell if you go. I've been there in the spirit. God have taken me to hell. It's a place you can't stay for 1 second. Hello? So you live as if you're dying the next day. Don't live as if you have more 10 years to live, or more 20 years, or more 30 years to live. That's a deception. Live as if you're living the world today. And you must give meaning to everyone's life. Any person you see, endeavor, strive to give meaning to them. Because you are called for a blessing. Say to somebody, I am called for a blessing. Oh, please talk to yourself. I am called for a blessing. So every day, look for something you can do for other people. There are people in this church that have been a blessing to me. And there are many people that have been a blessing to. That is how they work. That is how life work. The other day, my wife reminded me something that somebody did for us. No, reminded me how she's been blessed with something that somebody did for us. She said, I'm blessed with this. I said, okay. I said, but remember, somebody did it for you. She said, yes, I'm doing the same to other people. Be in that situation where you can bless the people and people can also bless you. Don't be a Red Sea. Only receiving, you don't pour out. Your life is about you. Hello? The Bible says, servant of God must not quarrel. 2 Timothy chapter 2, reading from 24 to 26. Is that a servant of God must not quarrel? Please, can we read the scripture? I have about 2-3 more scriptures to show you, and then we'll close. Maybe 2 scriptures more. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24 to 26. Because I'm showing you what it takes to be to live a higher righteous life. Hello? Shall we all read together? The Bible says, the lost slave must not what? Quarrel. Oh, I love the way, excuse me, what it is. Look at how we were described. Hello? You're all quiet on me today. Look at how we were described. We were described as what? Slave. We are slave of Jesus. We are not masters. I am not a master. I'm not a boss in this church. I'm one of the slaves. You see, the lost slave must know what? Quarrel. But must be gentle to everyone. Wow. Able to teach and patient. Just keep it there. Hold it there. Who is the Lord's servant, the bishop? Hello? Who is the Lord's servant? Is it the archbishop, the apostles, or the pastors? You're not talking to me. I thought I'm your friend. Eh? Hello, somebody. Who? Talk to me, somebody. Who? Everybody. The ushers. Did you say the ushers? Eh? Oh, God. Okay. The ushers are the Lord's servant. Then am I excluded? I must be an usher, somebody. They said the Lord's servant. Everyone. Because when you read scriptures like this, the temptation there is you might be thinking it's talking about our pastor. This scripture must be for pastor. We don't apply it ourselves. It said the Lord's servant must not quarrel, but must be gentle to everyone, able to teach and patient. Now look at why. Look, please, can I share the reason? Keep going. Verse 25. Oh, Rabbi Shiri. He said, instructing his opponents with what? Gentleness. Perhaps God will grant them repentance to know the truth. Now, the reason you ought to be gentle with them is because you want to win them to Jesus Christ. It's not because they are right. Because you want to see they're so safe. So you don't behave like them. Sometimes we are tempted to. I don't mean it should be fool in the street. No, that's not what I'm talking about. Because some people think that Christians are fool. You must also know how to represent Christ well. Stand on your certain right. But there are times you are not meant to quarrel. Maybe somebody's arguing with you about your church or about God and you're fighting with them. No, leave them for God. God is going to deal with such situation. Hello. So if you want to live a higher righteous life, be gentle with so many people. Sometimes they caution, but many times you need to be gentle and patient. Because if you're not gentle and patient with many people, there are people that they are Castros, and there are people that are Gaddafis in the church, but you're not even talking to me right now. So you must learn how to relate with all the Castros and the Gaddafis and the Johns and Peters in the church. Oh, you are not even talking now. I thought I'm talking to some people. So if you really want to carry Castro along, you cannot behave like Castro. If you want to carry, Gaddafi along, you cannot behave like Gaddafi. No way. If you behave like Gaddafi, you become like Gaddafi. The only way is to be gentle. And tomorrow, after many years, they will say, oh, that brother is such a good brother. I know what I did to him, but he still loved me. There are people living in this church. I do my best to reach out to them, and they still ignore me, but I'm still reaching out. Still reaching out. Hello? But how long? You ask, how long will you do that? But you've got to do it. They will be the one to testify about you. It may not be today, but someday they will talk about you. Hello, somebody. Now, show you probably this scripture, and I'll close. Thank you for your time. This scripture in Acts chapter 7, 54 to 60. Acts 7, 54 to 60. I was thinking, now, I want to quickly share this, the key to walk in the realm of exceeding righteousness is to have a glimpse of the future. The key to walk in the realm of exceeding righteousness is to have a glimpse of the future. Say to your neighbor, have a glimpse of the future. The Bible says God sees the end from the beginning, from ancient time, what is still to come. Psalm 46, verse 10. He said, God sees the end. Now, if God sees the end from the beginning, he expects you and me to see also the end from the beginning. Now, if you see the end from the beginning, it helps you not to react in the same manner that people are reacting to you, because you know where the story will end. Say to your neighbor, I know where this story is going to end. I just know it. It's going to work in my favor, Say to somebody, it's going to end for my favor. So when you see the end, you no longer yell just like unbelievers. When you're giving to God, you give with cheerfulness, because you know that it's coming back. Because what you give may leave your hand, but not your life. So you give now. You don't even mind. I'm still coming back to this scripture. What everybody's talking about or saying, or how you feel. When we started the church newly, my wife used to cook every Sunday very good food. My chapel, your witness, and bring to church. And we used to go through a lot of hardship. And one day I said to my wife, I said, did you buy stuff today? She said, no, she only bought stuff for church. I said, how comes we don't have something here and you're buying stuff for church? She said, if I feed the church, God will feed my family. And every morning she will wake up and she will cook. She did it. Still doing it once in a while now. She did it for years. Mama, you are alive here. And this time we used to go, the hardship is something I haven't seen before. I went through a lot in this country. Hello, somebody. And she said, no, if I feed them, God will feed me. And she endeavored to feed the church because she was seeing the future. If you see the future, it's difficult to throw in the towel, because you know your goodness is coming back. Hello, your love is coming back. Your grace is coming back. Everything you've done for people, you know is coming back. God is going to turn things around for you. I have enjoyed the grace of God in this nation in many ways, because I've been sacrificial in many ways. Hello, somebody. I've been sacrificial in many ways. And I'm telling you now, God has shown me his grace. I live in the grace of God. I'm going to come back to this scripture. I live a life of grace. I don't think about tomorrow. I don't read bills. I don't check bills. My wife is the head of bill, trying to see. She's the one that is worried with the bills. You don't even know the bill is due. I'm not thinking about bills. I hardly open bills. Hello, somebody. Hello. In the last years, 5 years or so, I don't know if I have ever opened bills. Unless I mistakenly open it. But even I open it, I don't read it very well. Are you not talking to me? You're not talking to me. My wife is the headmaster of bill opening and checking and noting, knowing the day. Oh, it's time to pay the bill. You don't even know that's time to pay. Oh, that bill. Don't worry. It's going to be paid. Oh, because you're not the one paying it. Oh God, I'm telling you the truth. She's alive. I don't check base. My life does not revolve around base. It revolves around the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I see the future. When you see the future, these things no longer matter. You live exuberant life in the spirit because you know it's just for now. The pain is just for now. The insult is just for now. The limitation is just for now. Some of you will be employing those that have employed you before. I'm telling you now, you will employ those who have employed you before. Now, I read this scripture close. I want to show you why is it, this is the best scripture I think you should most know done, and I'm done in this five minutes. Why is it that somebody like Philip, is it Philip? You hear, said to the people when he was, they stoned him to death, and Paul was keeping the clothes of those who were stoning him. He said, Lord, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Why is it that when people are persecuting you, wanting to kill you, you're saying, Lord, forgive them? I want to show you the secret. Hello? Are you here, somebody? Say to somebody, show me. I only saw this secret yesterday. I saw it as I read the scripture. I said, Lord, I've seen this, but I didn't even connect it. Now, let's look at this. Okay, please, before we read 54, please go to 54 and 6. 54 and 6. Read this with understanding. 54 and 6. Oh, shall we read? There's something wrong here. It should be 59. 59. Then. You have 59 there? Okay. They were stoning Stephen as he called out, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. When they were stoning him, he was not cursing them because he doesn't want to soil his higher righteous life. He doesn't want to soil because Steve has sacrificed so much for the kingdom. He mortgaged his life, invested his life in the kingdom. So when he was about to be stoned, look at his word. He said, they were stoning Stephen as he called out, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then verse 60. All about Satya. He said, then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And saying this, he fell asleep. Children of God do not die, we only fall asleep. You're not even listening to me. A child of God never dies. If you see any Christian that died, please only say they fall asleep. A Lord, he fell asleep. The Bible. If you look at, please stay here, somewhere in Book of Genesis, chapter 13, reading from 36, the Bible says, after David have served the will of God, he fell asleep. So children of God only fall asleep. You will not die in Jesus' name. Then I was saying, Lord, why did Steve say this? Why? Why not curse them? They were killing him. He was about to depart the world. He should have released the worst curse on them. Then 54, the Lord showed me something. And this should be the crowning, the apogee of the whole scripture today. Please note it down. Read from 54. He said, when they heard this thing, they were enraged in their heart and gnashed their teeth at him. He was saying something and they were angry with him. Keep going. Halesh Rondo. But Stephen, watch this. Shall we read? But Stephen, filled by the Holy Spirit, gazed into what heaven. You need to be filled by the Holy Spirit to see what is happening in the heavenly realms. He saw God's glory with Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, keep going. Look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Hello? Hello? Is there anybody here? He saw the heaven open. He saw Jesus standing at the right hand of his Father. He saw where he was going to be with God. So when they were killing him, he laughed. So I already saw something. Said to somebody, I already saw the future. He said, I already have seen something. So because of what he saw, he couldn't just act like them, talk like them, behave like them. He saw something that is bigger than his death, something that is bigger than his suffering, Something that is bigger than his humiliation. He saw it from afar. Wow. So he was more excited of what he saw rather than the people that were killing him. He didn't have time to catch them. So he ended up blessing them. Say, Lord, bless them for sending me to heaven. So he ended up blessing them because he saw that where I'm going is something bigger. We're bigger. Say to somebody, I'm going somewhere. Say to somebody, I'm going somewhere. I know I've taken your time, but please, I want you to take this. Stephen saw heaven open. He refused to curse his enemy. The key to stay on course, to live a higher righteous life, is to see the future. See beyond where you are. See from the eyes of the prophet. Hello, see. When you see what Christianity is all about, you see the privilege of Christianity, you know, the benefit of living for God and of doing what you're doing. You see the heaven open, and people will be saying, oh, you're doing too much. You're laughing at them because you know what you're doing. Am I talking to somebody? You're being too good. You say, I know where I'm going. You're giving too much money. You say, wow, it came from God. You're serving too much. You say, I have not even started. Oh, I thought I'm preaching to hot Christians. Hey, people are saying this thing because your eyes have seen, mama. He said, I will serve until I die. Because you know where you're going. Hallelujah. You know where you're going. Your eyes have seen the glory of God. Just before Martin Luther was killed, shot to death, you know, on Sunday, he declared, say, my eyes, if you watch this last message, have seen the glory of God. And he went and sat. And people like Jesse Justin, they all, you know, came and tapped his back. That was the last message he preached. Watch it. It's on YouTube. Say, my eyes have seen the glory of God. Say, I have been in the valley. Now I've been on the top mountains. And now my eyes have seen the glory of God. That day, Martin Luther prophesied about his death. And after that Sunday, he was killed. He said, I'm fighting because I've seen. Oh, Landro, Pakestayada. I'm preaching because I've seen. I'm giving because I've seen. I'm forgiving because I've seen. My eyes have seen the glory of God. My eyes have seen the future. So I will continue to preach the word. It doesn't matter what my flesh tests me. It doesn't matter what my finances test me. It doesn't matter what my bank account test me. It doesn't matter what my friends say against me. I will continue to stand because my eyes have seen the glory of God. I see heaven open and the Son of God standing on the right hand of God. Therefore, I'm going all the way. But Stephen refused to see his pain. He saw the glory. Are you seeing the glory? Are you seeing the pain? Are you seeing the sacrifice? Are you seeing the glory? Do you know where you're going? There is a glory greater than where we are today. The reason we are Christian is because there is a glory, a coming glory, a coming power. The reason we sacrifice so much. I've sacrificed so much. But I always said to my wife, I know there is a coming glory for me. God not only bless you here on earth, but he blesses you when you get there. And Lord, somebody, he will bless you here and will bless you there. I have not even started reaping my glory because something is about to happen. Say to your neighbor, I have not just started. I am still on course. Something is about to happen. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 18. Romans 8:18 is, I reckon that this present suffering is not to be compared with the glory that will be revealed to you on that day. Romans 8, verse 18. It says, your present pain, your present suffering is not to be compared with what will be revealed on that day. Karashabrando. Oh, glory. Go through it. Go through it. Go through it. Say to somebody, go through it. Holy Ghost is making me to stand here. I feel to talk to both of you. The Bible says, go through it.
just yet started. He said, pursue me. Pursue me. Because I will pull you. He said, daughter, pursue me. Don't pull back. Stop pulling back. Because there is something in your life. He will reveal his hand. And you will know that he is God. He'll pull you from the pit wherein there is no water. I will set you. Stand up and let us bless him. Parisi libra helendo supra. See the glory. Lebranda libruze kestenindo. Carabruzi li sekende lebro. Castena hande. Just bless his name. Bless his name. Open your mouth and bless his name. Libranze kestenuza. Lebranda libo sokeli kasendara. Lord, we bless your name. Somebody just bless his name. Somebody just bless his name. Horababos Libra Centuruba. Somebody bless his name. Put me a key prayers. Kuraba Sikrabalendo. Libru Zen Kaprozeya. Somebody go through it. Go through it. Go through the pain. Go through the insults. Go through the challenge. Somebody go through it. God have a plan. God has a plan for you. Open your mouth and pray. There is a plan. There is a coming glory. There is a coming power. He wants to open up the heavenlies. God is about to open up the heavenlies. God is about to open up the heavenlies. He is about to open up the heavenly just because of you. Just because of you. Keep on praying. Does a soft song, tarash te prena, lepras te hindo. Tap into the glory, tap into the glory. The heaven is already open. Oh, Rabba Baba Saka, tap into the heavenlies. I feel right now that the heavenlies open. Whatever you cook in the spirit right now is going to be done right now. Koluza prahende, zuka prezi, libro zentu sikapra. Increase the keyboards, create an atmosphere. Kabruse, Kaliz and them. Libruze hand, Zeprasika sura hand, Lebrande sulu hand, Kalish tuna ente prena hand, Legrasekas tu intro my hand. Lord, we bless your name. Yes, we bless your name. Somebody declare, we bless your name, Lord. Yes, we bless your name. Oh Lord, yes, we bless your name. Gabro de Helebro, Sempranda, we bless your name, Lord. Lord, we bless your name. Hey, Lord, I bless your name. There is a flame of God. I see flame all of a very strong flame. Helebro de, we bless your name. Oh Lord, I bless your name. Yes, Lord, I bless you. I walk in the glory. I tap the glory. The glory ramp. The glory ramp. The glory ramp. Yes, we bless you. Hallelujah. Yes, we bless you. Receive the anointing you need. Receive the presence you need. Receive the oil you need. Receive the glory you need. Kata praise tanto. Glory to God. Kalabo. Toro sala sata. A song you sing. Microphone for impartation, so your voice and your mouth will speak for the world. Touch with faith, touch for impartation. will speak through you. Speak for the world. Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. God, we honor you in this life. Where you have been shamed, you will be honored. Your voice will be heard. And those who have laughed at you will see you each time. Atmosphere is so hot in the spirit. It's charged. Only time constraint. But I feel a strong flame. I see it literally. Anyone that walk into this realm of the glory, his or her life will not remain the same again. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Father, raise this man of God. Father, raise Pastor Steve. Raise him in the presence of his enemies. May your leg walk into places you've never been. Preach this gospel. You will rise and shine, and men and women will see you from afar. Thank you, Lord. I don't feel to close, but I have to do that. Mama came, that came from Napier. What's the name of her mama that came from Napier? Mama, how are you? God is interested in your life. You're a woman of God. You have the word of eternal life in your tongue. And you have done a lot in the past for him, but you have not started. There's still more God wants to use you to do. Your voice will be like a razor that will cut off things from the life of man. God is beginning to honor you. This is just the beginning. Thank you, Lord. We want to walk into the realm of the glory. Father, I want to walk into the realm. Father, take me to the realm of glory, Father. Lord, cause me to see a glimpse of your glory. A glimpse of your power, Lord. Father, cause me, Lord, to taste a glimpse of your glory. Cause me, Father. Father, in this nation, do something with speed of light. Lord, open the heaven, Father, and release all that belong to the church, my Father. Open the heaven and release all that belong to your children. Oh God, thank you, Lord. I want to share the grace because.